Okay, welcome everybody to another one of our podcasts. This is Hugh over in Gloucestershire, and I think I'm squinting down the screen. Yes, there's Phil in London, so there he is. So today we have got a little discussion about KVM over IP. This is handling, you know, computer, video, mouse or something. Phil, perhaps you'd give us some more detail.
Yeah, so this is obviously something that's been rearing up for many years as we've become more workstation centric, as we've moved from very, very expensive, you know, custom built broadcast electronics made by the likes of Mr. Sony and Mr. Ampex, 20, 30 years ago, to now everything being done on a commodity computer, you know, a Mac, mm-hmm. or a typically a Hewlett Packard Windows workstation or Linux workstation, maybe.
Yeah.
Big facilities where people, will often need to get hold of a machine from a distance. And this is a technology, or this is a requirement that's been around really since the introduction of computers in the television production process. So for many, many years, we were using gadgets like this. I've got a few bits of show and tell on my workstation benchmarking. This is a Geffen DVI extender.
Oh, yes.
And you can see on the back there's the DVI port, and there are the fiber optic connectors. And so that will over, well, in the case of this one, four cores of a fiber optic cable, this will extend a DVI display. That's, you know, kind of was very commonly used probably 10 years ago. We used to put in lots of that stuff. Here's a very typical kind of, this is a bit more cheap and cheerful, but this is your USB extender. So again, you know, USB doesn't go more than about 10 meters just on passive cables.
No.
A gadget like this plugs into the back of the workstation and then turns that into a Cat5, Cat6, Cat7 type connector. And then at the other end, at the edit suite end or the production control desk end or whatever, there's the other end. It gives you it's a USB hub at the other end. So the technologies for extending KVM are well established, been around for 20 years or whatever,
mm-hmm.
and we've all been very used to it. And I suppose about 15 years ago, there was more of a requirement for things like things could be switched. Somebody might be sitting in a control room and might have to take control of several different machines. Maybe a transmission supervisor has to flip between several transmission servers or something of that order. And so Raritan were big in those early analog VGA KVM type systems, and although they extend over Cat5 type cable, they're still kind of signal format converters. I've got I've got one back here. I should grab it. And these are still kind of reasonably commonly used in server rooms. And so typically you've got a gadget like this, and this one's got VGA and PS2 style keyboard and mouse, and that converts it into a Cat5 again. That's the sort of ubiquitous, a very similar gadget, same deal, VGA and USB converts it into Cat5, and then they'd all be connected to something like this. It's a very simple sort of 1U sort of matrix switcher, and from one position or two positions you could pick up control of many KVMs, keyboard, video, mouse, servers, workstations, whatever. But again, not doing anything more clever than converting those RGB signals. And it's brutally simple. They put the red, the green, and the blue on each on its own twisted pair on the Cat5 cable, and then they'll use the last twisted pairs, four twisted pairs in the Cat5. They use the last one for the keyboard and the mouse and some status data, and that works very, very well. I mean, extending that high bandwidth, 500 megahertz bandwidth RGBs over twisted pair copper cable is often a challenge, and you often get kind of blurry, fuzzy pictures that you have to like wind in a lot of EQ to make them look good. But for a long time that was the accepted way of doing things, and then we got.
Phil, but they come out over Cat5, but you can't route them through an IP switcher, can you?
Absolutely, absolutely. They are just electrical signals on a Cat5 cable. So then, maybe 10 years ago, the requirement for turning these things into IP and being able to route them over the IP backbone of a facility became quite prominent. There are a couple of big players. There's these people, Avasant. They've been around for probably 10 years. They're part of Emerson now, but part of a big American company, and they take 2 DVIs and a USB and some audio or whatever and packetize them, put them onto your IP network, and so long as you can get to the IP network at the other end, 200 meters away across the other side of the campus or whatever, you can pull the data off, and you've got a hopefully a seamless and transparent desktop extension technology. Mm-hmm. There's quite a lot of people in television use this system. Technicolor are big users of it. Deluxe, the big kind of film people, because it's very expensive. You know, each endpoint's £1,000, and then you've got to have high end switches. You know, kind of corporate grade switches that support elaborate protocols like IGMP and things like that. And mm-hmm. you've got to have lots of good bandwidth, because typically these things will max out the gigabit connection. They'll take all the bandwidth they want. And the reason they have to do that is because you think about one DVI connection, that's 1.65 gigabits per second. You've got two of those maybe, and then USBs, la-di-da. So even with, you know, sort of half decent compression, you're still looking at quite high bandwidths. And so Avacent were the, when we started to consider what product we should go behind here at Route 6, initially we looked at Avacent because we knew several of our customers used it already. But it's expensive, and so really only appeals to those big kind of film type customers. And it makes quite stringent requirements on your network. A very similar manufacturer, Adalink, they're much, much the same space. Interestingly, these guys come from the world of air traffic control. Their products all came from extending radar displays, which are a contemporary radar display is a 2048 by 2048 pixel DVI signal. So it's a dual link DVI signal. Yeah, it uses all 29 pins of a dual link DVI connector, mm-hmm. and so that's where they came from. Yeah, who knew that there was a business big enough to support a manufacturer who just did radar display extension, but that's where they came from, and they've been making big waves in the television, film and television industry for a few years now. Again, their compression, although is impressive, still requires them to max out a gigabit Ethernet connection to be able to get from A to B, which, you know, on a modern contemporary network is not a big deal. You know, that's not such an onerous requirement. It only becomes an onerous requirement if you then want to extend that stuff over a low bandwidth network, like the public internet, for example.
Of course.
Or over leased connections, which, you know, top out at a certain bandwidth. But after lots of investigation, and I've got some pages ripped from a presentation about this. So KVM technology, a time who's come. So our thinking very much was, we had to be able to offer a solution where we could talk sensibly about extending within buildings, you know, from the MCR to the edit suite, to the grading room, to the audio room, whatever, across the campus. Because increasingly, and I know you've been up in Media City this last week, you know, you've got Doc 10 running their studios at one end of a huge campus, and then you've got broadcasters, you know, the BBC, ITV or whatever, at the other end of the campus. And Cat 6 cable doesn't go that far. Cat 6 cable goes 100 meters for gigabit Ethernet. And so there's got to be some consideration. How do we get it to go further? Do we have to have fiber in place to make it go further? Or is it routable over, over IP technology? And then the ultimate is, what happens if the editor wants to be able to sit in his hotel room and start editing on the Avid back at base? To start doing a rough cut, maybe, you know, is that possible at all? And those were all the kind of things we had to consider when we were looking at KVM over IP technology. The final point is that ideally, neither the user nor the workstation nor the application running on the workstation should be aware that any of this magic has taken place. We don't want to have to be installing drivers and special bits of software.
Yeah.
Because, you know, particularly with Avid, you know that that's going to break a media composer. You know, Avid is so fussy about their hardware configuration, about the software environment, et cetera, et cetera. These are all kind of considerations. And a lot of this is about keeping the workstation in the machine room where it can be cooled. Where it doesn't have to be making noise in the hero suite, in the flame room, or in the high-end grading room or whatever, and where it can be attached to the fiber channel storage, for example, and you don't want to go to the expense of extending the fiber channel storage up to the edit room. So these are the reasons, you know. And so there's what we've talked about already, the idea of using DVI balance, turning it DVI into fiber and sending it over fiber, that kind of thing. But we're really at a point now where we have to be able to say, actually, you know, we'd like to be able to employ much more aggressive compression for dealing with what we want to send over the network. You know, we don't want to have to, just destroy our network with hundreds of gigabit, you know, maxed out gigabit connections being routed over our backbone infrastructure. And so the nice thing about Teradici, which is a Canadian chipset manufacturer, who a lot of people implement their chipset in their KVM products that they use a very adaptive method for extending the dual DVI displays. They typically they use MPEG-4 for the video content. Mm-hmm. So if their chipset identifies moving video within the DVI image, they deploy an MPEG-4 codec to take care of that. They use PostScript. A PostScript compressor for where they identify text in the image. They use a run-length encoder for graphics. So if there's graphics images that don't fit into those other two use cases, they use a run-length encoder. And if it's something they don't recognize, they use wavelets. So you've got four different compression types in Teradici products. And so you get a very, very complicated bit stream, and you need, you know, something clever at the other end to turn that back into the dual DVI displays.
Are they identifying this within the picture, or is it sort of per frame? How does it?
The encoder looks on a per frame basis at the DVI displays, mm-hmm. and on a per frame basis, it's identifying where it thinks video is, where it thinks text is, graphics and stuff it doesn't recognize, and it's deploying different compressors for each of those requirements. So I'm going to go back to my browser now. So Teradici, as I say, they're a Canadian manufacturer, and they manufacture this technology that they refer to as PCOIP, PC, you know, personal computer over IP.
I see.
You know, everybody else calls it KVM over IP. But that's their, that they make the chipsets. They don't particularly make products. But because they are a third party, they're not the people who are making the products. So let's go back to my presentation pages here. They have maybe, so there's a grab from their website, and you can see there we've got a drop down list of the people who implement, yeah. and they're all the usual names: Dell, Wise, EVGA, Fujitsu, Hewlett Packard, and that's only kind of half the list. Cisco, Box Technologies, Amulet Hotkey. Now Amulet Hotkey is the one we identified as being the extender system that we liked at Route 6, for several reasons. It's a Teradici solution, so you aren't bound to one manufacturer. And let me grab a here's a generic Teradici card, and I can't honestly remember who makes this one. I have a feeling this is an EVGA card, but this is a full height PCIe card, and you can see it's just two lanes of the PCIe bus there. It doesn't have an onerous requirement on the computer in question. And then if you look at the back, you can see the four DisplayPort inputs and a network connection. And so what the card does is it takes the outputs of your graphics card. So you stick with your normal graphics card, your Radeon or your Nvidia graphics card, and you feed as many inputs as you want to into the display port inputs of this card. And you might have to get some little adapter cables to do that, but that's the way it's done. And then that, along with a USB that it hosts on the motherboard itself, and a Realtek sound chip that's on the card as well, means that you've got displays and USB and audio in and out being packetized and turned into a network feed there. Cool. And it really is an honest to goodness TCP/IP network feed that goes over a regular network and can actually be routed over the public internet as well. At the other end, you have something that looks like this. This is what they call a zero client. This is an Amulet one, but there are a dozen manufacturers making them. And you can see on the back there's the four DisplayPort outputs. And there's a network connector and an auxiliary network connector. So this is the thing that saves me so often. I'm up in the edit suite and I want to connect my laptop to the Amulet network, the Teradici network, I should say, to do some diagnostics. And it's like, oh, I've got to run back down to the machine room, have I, and connect to the server where all the network switches are. And they say, no, there's an auxiliary port on the back of the Zero client. You can get into the network there, which is a lifesaver. It's like really helped me out so many times. And then on the front, you can see we've got audio in and out, and a USB hub. A couple on the front, a couple on the back. And so that's packetized up essentially your whole PC's desktop experience and put it over the network. And that's really good. And it can either be done with one of these internal cards, or it can be done with, and I'm going to switch to another camera here rather splendidly.
Cool. Terribly posh.
A USB
camera. Anybody would think you work in television, you know.
So actually, that's the back of it. You can see what we're looking at there is a 19-inch 3U high rack mount enclosure. I've only got one card in this enclosure, and that's an external card. And you can see the power supply there as well. And the enclosure comes with redundant power supplies because it's got a serious bit of kit. Now, I haven't turned it on yet because it's got a noisy fan in it, which I will turn it on in a minute just to see it working. And so... Mm-hmm. In the case of a computer where you don't want to put a PCIe card in the computer because it's a fancy new Mac Pro, mm-hmm. or it's an Avid workstation where Avid won't provide technical support if you've deviated from their turnkey configuration, or it's a Tektronix waveform monitor which doesn't have a PCIe slot like the Apple computer, you can have an external card which sits in a chassis, and then if I then take this camera and point it at the back of this Mac Pro, so you can see what's connected up here. You can see that we've got, it's actually a dual output graphics card, but I didn't have a display port to DVI breakout adapter. So I've only got one DVI connector connected to it. And you can see there's a USB connected to it, and we've got the regular network connected to this computer. But, that's not what we're dealing with today. It's the only network we're really thinking about today is the network on
coming out of the back of
coming out of the Amulet Hotkey connector. So that's probably the more sort of pro end of the market, because that's what you're going to be sticking in your server cabinet, or your cabinet with all your Avids in. Just move that picture out of the way there, and let's scroll down here a second. So look, there's a picture from ITV's facility in Media City in Salford. There's one cabinet there with you see there's what's probably 20 external cards, all connected to Avids in the cabinets either side of where we're seeing. And there's mm-hmm. there's a slightly different model of internal card. That one only supports two displays on a card.
Yeah.
Well, that's very standard for our industry, isn't it? Two 24-inch monitors for your Avid workstation. That's very sort of standard, or your Final Cut Pro or your Adobe Premiere. But apparently, if you're working in financial services, apparently having four or eight displays is not unusual. Financial traders will often have that, and so Amulet made their money as an integrator for the financial services industry. They're the Teradici integrator of choice for big banks and big trading floors and things like that. So that kind of and you think, wow, those guys are serious about security. They're serious about five nines uptime and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what we'll come to talk to a bit later when we talk about encryption. Because that's actually quite a key feature of these KVM over IP systems and why we choose the way we choose. So I'm going to go back to my browser. There we go. Because as well as all those manufacturers, we saw Cisco, Dell, EVJ, Amulet, Hotkey, etc. People like LG have desktop computer monitors with the Teradici hardware built into them, into the back of them.
Oh.
So you can have DVI monitors with just a network connector on the back, and you connect your keyboard and mouse to the hub on the monitor. You connect the network to the back of the monitor, and then that will then just allow you to connect to the Teradici host somewhere else in a facility.
So just as I understand, does that mean that any of those manufacturers, encoders, if you will work with any other manufacturer's decoder?
Exactly, or? Right. Yes. Yeah. So if you're implementing the Teradici chipset, you have to abide by their design recommendations, which means that you have to play nicely with all the other manufacturers of Teradici product. So we've got one customer, MPC, Moving Picture Company, big VFX house here in London, and they've bought Amulet from us a few times. So they've got quite a lot of Amulet, particularly for their Flame workstations, where again, putting an internal card in the machine is a bit of a no-no because that breaks a turnkey solution. But they have a real mix across their facility. They have some EVGA product. I think they have some Dell product. And it all plays nicely with each other. And even the software management tools play nicely with the various parts. So even the console manager software that allows you to interrogate these devices, upgrade their firmware, all that kind of stuff, is agnostic, so long as they follow the Teradici implementation rules. That's rather splendid. And what it means is what it means is that you're not looking at a single manufacturer's costs. So here's a little table I've got here of this is what I give to the sales guys, of Adalink, Avacent, the two guys we've already talked about, who were kind of earlier to the party, I suppose. Think Logical, who are a manufacturer who sell to the military a lot, but you see them occasionally in film and TV. They're very expensive, but they're not over IP, they're over over fiber links. And then our friends, Amulet Hotkey. And so, if you look at the cost per seat, a typical rollout, you're looking at nearly £2,000 Adalink and Avacent. Amulet, depending on the configuration you go for, you're looking at, two-thirds of that cost on a per suite basis. And we have a good feel for this now because we've got 88 seats of this stuff at ITV in Manchester. We've got 78 seats of it at IMG Sports in Chiswick Park. MPC have a few dozen seats of it. National Geographic, Fox. We've got a lot of customers.
You've got morale effects,
running, and split across VFX, broadcast, post-production, even education. So it's a system we feel very comfortable with. We sold in the last 3 years, sold quite a lot of, and we kind of stand by it. And I suppose the point I'm trying to get to is I felt we were quite thorough when we made our choice of going through all these different requirements, and you get lots of resellers who will base their product choices on what makes us the best margin. I've kind of always resisted that. I've always thought, what actually brings the best, to the customer? And for me, Amulet Hotkey, with very, very few exceptions, is the one that I think, suits the customers the best, Scalability, security, all that kind of stuff. Now,
so if you're out in the field or an MPC buying from a number of places, looking for a Teradici chipset, you might listen to what Uncle Phil says and say, right, I'm going to buy an Amulet Hotkey. But then a bit later down the line, a chap on a market stall has some other Teradici compatible products for a lot less. You might want to plug one of those in, and it wouldn't be a foolish mistake. What kind of things would you be looking for to say to your to your financial director, no, I do need to have them?
Okay, well, let's go back to the modern day marketplace, which is of course eBay, and here we go. I just did a search for Teradici cards, and look, here is some no name, one hung low brand, manufactured at some factory in Shenzhen province, $49 for a Teradici host card, and that's actually got a graphics chip on it as well. That's actually got the graphics. It doesn't require a graphics card. Here's some Dell ones, there's more Dell ones. In fact, they're mostly Dell, aren't they? Again, there's a very expensive one. I don't know why that's so expensive. But there is a plethora of manufacturers. And in fact, the first thing, the thing we often struggle with is we've got one customer who I won't name on the podcast, but who they are because you've worked for them. And they bought a bunch of Amulet 2 years ago, now they're expanding it. And they said to us, why should we buy, those Amulet Zero clients to sit on our desks? Because they're blinking £400 each, And look, I can pick up a Hewlett Packard one for $99 on eBay. Why don't I just buy that? Well, of course you can buy that. But I mean, the nice thing about Amulet is for a start, this one is a current model. Doesn't have a fan in it, so it's perfect for an audio suite. A lot of these devices have fans in them. But it's, this is a metal case and it has a 3-year warranty. And, Amulet will respond day and night kind of thing. The other nice thing about Amulet is there's an issue we talked about on our Display Technologies podcast about 18 months ago, called temporal dithering. I'm going to find a bit about that. Temporal dithering is this effect where, for the longest time, Apple cinema displays and the internal displays on their laptops have been 8-bit displays, whereas the rest of the PC industry has been 10-bit displays for a long time, 10-bit RGB for a long time. And so to try and make that a bit more, give the visual illusion of a bit more colour depth, Apple have this feature in their graphics drivers, which, in fact, the manufacturer of the graphics cards do this. So Radeon, now owned by AMD, and NVIDIA, this thing called temporal dithering, where each pixel, that if the pixel doesn't lie on the color, on the 10-bit color space they're trying to reach, they'll choose the nearest color in 8-bit color space, but they'll dither the value either side, so as to give the visual effect of a color that you can't really display.
And so your eye will do the averaging.
Your eye will do the averaging, and you'll get optically a better color depth than you would with just using 8-bit straight values. Now, the problem with this is that if you're then having to compress that image and send it over an IP connection, every single frame of the DVI stream is 110% different from the frame that came before, which means that any compression system, no matter how clever, is now broken. There is no redundancy to be compressed out of those images. And so the first time, and this is probably 3 years ago at a job for NBC Universal, we ran up a bunch of Mac rooms. All of a sudden we thought, my word, these pictures look appalling. They just look like, you know, just the worst YouTube video clips, you know. And the mouse is lumpy as anything, and this is unusable. And so we went to Amulet, and they said, aha, that's temporal dithering. And they already had kernel extensions for OS X to turn off temporal dithering, because there is no control panel in the Mac operating system for switching on and off features of graphics cards drivers. Not like there is on Windows. In Windows, you can dive into the registry and you can tweak around with graphics cards drivers to your heart's content. In fact, because gamers are so obsessed with tweaking the last ounce of performance out of their graphics cards, if you've got NVIDIA or Radeon, the control panels that come with those products, you can change pixel clock timings, and you can really get in there and mess your card up if you want to. But part of that is you can turn temporal dithering off if you don't like it. And for some reason, it's never turned on the PC versions anyway, because PC displays tend to be 10-bit anyway. But it's turned on by default under Mac, and it's very hard to turn off unless you write a kernel extension to load at boot time and turn it off. Now, Amulet have gone to all this trouble to write kernel extensions for this. And in fact, wouldn't you know it, every time a major release of OS X comes along, the kernel extension breaks, and Amulet have to rewrite it. Yeah. We're currently going through this pain with Yosemite at the moment. And in fact, it's even changed between 10.10.2 and 10.10.3, it breaks. And so, Amulet, to their credit, have always stayed on top of this. But of course, because Amulet don't particularly want other people kind of nicking their kudos and being able to, exploit their intellectual property, the first thing their kernel extension does when it loads is to check, is there Amulet hardware in the house? And if there is, it'll run. If there isn't, it won't. So there's one reason for kind of doing the right thing. Don't expect to be able to use those more elaborate tools written by Amulet if you didn't bother to buy Amulet gear. So
that's true.
We kind of feel that they're a proper manufacturer. They're a British manufacturer based in Devon, and they have offices in London Bridge, and they're just a bit more slick and polished and on the case than the one hung low brand cards you can buy on eBay for $49.99. So pays your money, takes.
So there is a difference. There are some actual differences. It's the support
Support and the after sales.
Especially if you're using Apple, then really, if you're doing serious work, then
If you're renting really that room out at hundreds of pounds a day, do you really want to make your engineer's life a misery by buying rubbish?
Met the engineer. Yes.
So that's why we recommend Amulet as a proper manufacturer. Now,
interesting.
The one area where Amulet are unique is that they are the only people who have the external hardware. Yeah, they're the only people who make these external cards. There are no other Teradici manufacturers who make external cards. And so what some customers have done, MPC, is that they buy all their external cards from Amulet, but they buy other well-known brand cards for use on internals. And the understanding is that the tricky situation using a Mac Pro, which where we want the kernel extension to work, and it's all a bit more kind of against the wire kind of thing, then we're happy to buy the expensive external Amulet cards. But for those internal kind of server extensions where it's a bit more vanilla, it's a bit more easy, they buy Dell cards or whatever, and that's entirely reasonable. I wouldn't blame anybody for wanting to economize, particularly since the external cards are blinking expensive. Because whereas on that, let's go back to my internal camera, Whereas on that internal card, that's about a £350 piece, this card, but the fact of the matter is, it doesn't have a power supply because it's getting power off the PCIe bus. Yeah. Doesn't even have to host the USB or the audio because those are being hosted on the PCIe bus of the computer. Whereas if you've got an external card, how do you emulate that? How do you emulate the USB and the audio? And actually, what you have to do is you have to have another computer. And so these external cards, let me just drag this one out of its enclosure. So these external cards, apparently had its firmware updated by yours truly just 3 weeks ago. There we go.
Look at that.
So these external cards, if I crack this card open, if I take this cover off, actually, there's two distinct chipsets in here. There's the Teradici chipset. It's exactly the same chipset that was on the PCIe card. But there's also, down this end of the card, there's a Linux system on chip. And actually, they host a full build of Linux on the card just to be able to provide hosting for the audio chipset and the USB chipset, which means that, the thing that's often spoken a lot in KVM over IP circles is, do they support Wacom cards? Because Wacom cards are notoriously badly behaved. There is apparently a specification as part of the PCI, part of the USB spec that says that USB devices have to respond within a certain number of milliseconds when they're queried by the host bus adapter. So when there's an interrupt asserted on the PCIe bus that tells the USB chipset, go and see if anybody wants to deliver any USB data back at this point. And then the USB hub chipset, goes and has a look and issues the, anybody got any USB data for us kind of thing. And everything is meant to happen in quite a sort of timely fashion. But apparently Wacom graphics tablets, and some of them do it worse than others. The current model Bamboo ones are particularly bad, but the Intuos 3s and 4s were also pretty bad. They'll just spray out data whenever they fancy, And this is presumably just because it's cheaper to build a graphics tablet that spews out the data as you swipe the pen across the surface. It must be more expensive to build a graphics tablet that has some memory on board, that buffers the data, sends it out in a timely fashion as per the specification. But so long as you're attached to the chipset on the motherboard, PCs are so fast and this kind of thing, it doesn't really matter. You'd have to have, a very quick robot arm waggling over a graphics tablet to be able to max out, the throughput onto the bus. So it doesn't really matter if you're directly connected to the computer. If, however, you're connected across an IP connection, which is dependent on things being packetized up and delivered in a timely fashion, that's deadly. And so we went through several iterations of the Amulet card firmware. In fact, I think this one's only been upgraded twice. Yeah, if you look at the upgrade record, it's only been done twice. But we've got some cards that have had like 8 or 9 versions of firmware on them. As we discovered different blinking Wacom tablets that didn't work, Amulet would rewrite the firmware just to accommodate that badly behaved tablet. And so eventually they said, enough is enough. We have to write kind of a catch-all case. And so what they did was, apparently, they extended out the buffer window so that it was wider than the overall round time of USB. So no matter how badly behaved the device was, you'd catch it in your buffer and it would be available the next time you wanted to deliver the USB data. So, Amulet have been very responsive in that respect, and I don't know that we'd have got the same thing out of other manufacturers. It's yet another reason why we like those guys. Yeah. There's another thing that has bitten us in the backside quite a lot. I don't know if you've ever noticed, Hugh, on an Avid, if you've got Media Composer running, if you disconnect one of the DVI monitors and reconnect it, Avid will say, "Oh, change of monitor. I need to restart Media Composer." Now, that's because when you plug a monitor in, it asserts pin 16 on the DVI connector. It drags it low or drags it high. I don't remember which. I've banged on about it endlessly on my blog because it was a problem for us for quite a while. And so the pin 16 asserts an interrupt on the PCI bus, which there we go, which then forces the graphics card driver, in the case of Windows, to do an EDID exchange. So the graphics card will then say to the monitor, "Well, what kind of monitor are you?" And the monitor will return with an EDID profile that basically specifies resolution, frame rate, color space, even the serial number of the monitor, and lots of other information about it. But Windows is well behaved. Windows will then say, the Windows Display Manager will then say, "Oh, you're the same resolution and the same frame rate as the last guy I saw. I'm not going to do anything," which is precisely exactly what it should do. Avid, as soon as it sees the pin 16 interrupt, irrespective, it doesn't even look and see what EDID profile comes back. Avid will say, "Oh, I've got to restart. You know, nothing else to do. Just got to restart." And so that's a bit daft, really. You know, wanting to restart Media Composer just because a monitor became disconnected and reconnected. But think about that now in terms of a KVM system. When you press disconnect on your Edit Suite box, you know, when you press the disconnect button there, and you disconnect from the workstation you're attached to, and you go and pick up control of another workstation, that new workstation, because the system has to be able to tell the new workstation how big the monitors are that are attached to this zero client in the Edit Suite, it will say, here's some new monitors. It will assert pin 16, and then there'll be a EDID exchange, and so the operating system then gets to see what monitors have come to the party. Now, in a big facility where typically you've got 24-inch Dell monitors, all the same resolution, all 1920 by 1200, all identical or very, very similar monitors, you think that should be painless. You think, you know, the editor should be able to press disconnect on his zero client, phone up his operator and say, "Oh, I'm going home now. Can you finish off for me?" And the operator who's sitting in the media management area picks up control of that Avid and finishes off. Well, in the case of ITV, that was quite a common occurrence. And the worst thing was, editors would press the disconnect button, phone their oppo and say, "I've just started my layback. Can you watch the layback for me?" And they clear off home. So the oppo would then go and take control of that Avid to watch the layback. And the Avid would say, "Oh, new monitors. Got to restart." And the layback would be ruined. You have to start again. And guess what? We were only half an hour away from the blinking, you know, news bulletin or whatever. So we had to work out some way of stopping graphics cards from being able to detect new monitors being connected. And so, you know, I dug through this an awful lot, and our poor old my poor old trainee Wesley, he spent ages with soldering iron and whatever, making up sort of test cables and such. And eventually we developed a solution that worked nicely, and we got a factory in China to manufacture us a little passive adapter here, you know, DVI male to DVI female, and there's just a little, you know, divider network in there that holds pin 16 at the correct voltage, so that the graphics card never ever gets to see a change of monitor. Because you know, in a big pro facility where you've got Avids and you've got all the same model of monitor, there's no benefit in the Avids ever getting a sniff of the fact that they're now having other monitors attached to them. And a lot of people have said to us, "Oh, well, you know, this is a failing of the system. Surely the KVM should take care of this." Actually, I think the KVM does exactly what it should do. The KVM should always tell the computer when new monitors have been brought to the party. Because consider this, the worst case is that you go from an Edit Suite that had a pair of 24-inch monitors to maybe a lower end room that's got a pair of 19-inch monitors. If there was no way for the zero client to be able to do an EDID pass back to the sender device and then tell the graphics card, "Oh, we've got new monitors now," you know, you just have black, because, you know, the workstation would be driving those monitors at a too high a resolution for them to be able to display anything. So yeah. I actually think, you know, Amulet does exactly the right thing, and all KVMs do the right thing, but it's Avid that has this stupid habit of wanting to restart every time it sees a change of monitor. But the Root 6 Spoofomatic, which, if you look on our website, that's what they're called. They're called the Spoofomatic, and we give them away essentially with every Amulet we sell. I think the one Hung Lo factory in Shenzhen province manufactures them for me at about £4 a piece. So that's rather splendid. So that's kind of KVM over IP. That's why we chose Amulet, why we still love Amulet, why they've been a great sort of supplier for us. It's very responsive, very supportive. You know, they've done lots of training with us. They've even kind of shown us how to do quite in-depth diagnostics and repair on their cards, how to get into them over the serial interface, get into the Linux backend, all that kind of stuff. You know, they really are, you know, very responsive.
So is there a lot of setting up to do with these things? I mean, the thing that would spring to mind if you haven't tried any is lag. You know, are you going to get lag? And
so the lag through the Amulet system is it's sub a frame of DVI. I think if memory serves, it's about 20 milliseconds. So nobody ever complains about it. Now, there is one instance, or there is one case where you're using Amulet over long, long distances. So we've got a couple of customers who work between Britain and America, or Britain and the continent, because they've got people working overnight on the same VFX workstations in Los Angeles who are working on them in London during the daytime. Now, because Amulet has got this like four-way compression, or I should say Teradici solutions have this four-way compression system, you can actually run them at very, very low data rates and still get a very acceptably, you know, nice desktop. So a couple of years ago at the what's the big trade show we all go to in Docklands, used to be in Earl's Court, what's it called?
BVE.
Broadcast Video Expo. Broadcast. That's the fella. Yeah. Used to be called the Video Forum, didn't it?
That's right.
Beloved of the Guild of Wedding Videographers. So we had a demo there where we had a media composer back at our offices in Soho and a Xero client on the desk at BVE. And we had a 10 megabit connection back to the office. You know, we'd leased a 10 megabit connection. Just 10 megabits, you know, think about your domestic ADSL, you know, 20 megabits, you know, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Domestic fiber, 50 megabits. And that was very, very usable. Occasionally, you know, the video would break up on the video playback window. But at 10 megabits, you're thinking, hey, you know, this is like nearly 4 gigabits of data that I'm watching over a 10 megabit pipe. You know, it's remarkable.
It can only ever be a representation. It can't be the actual.
Now, the nice thing that Teradici does is that they do this thing called build to lossless, where as soon as there's a static frame, they stop worrying about changes and any lack of detail in the image, they will build they'll build the image back to lossless. So for compositing and for VFX artists, they're perfect, because as soon as you hit the spacebar and the video playback stops, within milliseconds, boom, you're back at full resolution. And so that's really quite nice. And so even over single megabit, you know, 10 megabits, 8 megabits, Amulet is very usable. Now, the case of working across the Atlantic, typically people who do that don't have a lack of bandwidth. You know, they have a bit
They're not going across the public internet in the usual way.
Well, they may be, but they've probably got quite a lot of leased bandwidth. But the thing that you can't avoid between, you know, London and Los Angeles, there's 200 milliseconds of ping round trip. You know, pick a server in Los Angeles and ping it, and it's 200 milliseconds for the packets to get there and back. And the upshot of that is that your mouse pointer feels very lumpy. You know, almost the point of being not very nice to use. And one of our sales guys had a good old go at me about, this product is not fit for purpose, you know. And I said, it's just the speed of light, you know. It's just, that's the limitation, you know. If you want that to be improved, take it up with a higher authority. You know, a firmware upgrade is not going to fix this. You know, this is just the way the universe is. And so the nice thing that Teradici have done is that they have this little trick whereby, and this is the one case where you do have to run a little driver bit of software on the workstation. They suppress the mouse on the workstation, and the mouse then gets recreated at the Xero client. So the mouse is being created locally. And that is enough to give you the illusion of immediacy. Because if you think about how you use a mouse, you drive the mouse to where the button is, and then you click. You know, that makes Teradici products, Amulet, those kind of things, work very nicely over very, very long distances.
How interesting.
So that's, and again, you could never do that with these products that require, you know, a gigabit connection, and that's the end of it. Got to have a gigabit connection. Yeah. There you go. So the one consideration with Teradici products over the public internet is that you have to have a VPN. I've got a couple over there. I'll grab one maybe. We've found when we tested a few, and they weren't all perfect. But Zeissel make a very nice VPN endpoint. It's just that it looks like a router, just like several Ethernet connections on the front, and it basically will terminate an Ethernet endpoint for you. And so with a pair of those, and so long as they both have an internet connection, they can find each other wherever they are in the world, and they will then bring up a VPN, a virtual private network, between them, And so it now looks like the zero client at the remote location is on the same local area network as the sender card in the machine room of the facility. And so we've done, although they've not bought from us yet, we've done a lot of demoing with ITN for remote editing. So editing on an Avid in our dev office in Poland Street from from their offices in Gray's Inn Road. And then we extended that out further to Birmingham. And then to Glasgow, and you know, just with, so you show up at your hotel room literally with one of these VPN endpoints and with the Amulet Zero client, and using the television in the hotel room, HDMI into the television in the hotel room, you can have an editing interface that's very, very usable back to base, and it's over a VPN, so it's secure, and they've been very impressed with that. Clearly not impressed enough to buy anything yet, but we live in hope. But this is the this is kind of one of the other pieces of this whole kind of you know, pop-up post, you know, all that kind of stuff that people are talking about, being able to quickly bring up facilities remotely with nothing but the internet as your connectivity. So that's I suppose a bit of an overview. So now I'm going to switch back to that other camera, and I'm going to fire up an Amulet session. So actually, I'll probably edit this out, but I'm just going to move the microphone over here, move off camera myself, plug this beautiful. Let's go back to that camera. So here we go. And you can plug these in hot, you know, they're very, very tolerant. And you'll notice that this card has, again, like the Zero client, it's got two Ethernet jacks in the front. Again, that's saved me so many times where I've been over at the Amulet bays in the machine room, and you don't have to schlep all the way down to the network bays to be able to jack your laptop in. To be able to do it, you know, just being able to go in there, and that's just hubbed internally. And so you go in there, and like an ITV where they've got 88 sender cards and like nearly 100 receiver stations, you know, I can get into any Amulet piece of equipment in the building literally by jacking in on one card. Fab. That's on the network. So very nicely kind of set up. So let's just come back here a second. This thing will make a big old racket, as kit does, you know.
Yes.
So again, remember where you know our this Mac Pro is connected single USB and a DVI. I haven't bothered hosing up the audio yet, but audio in and out is doable as well. It should be noted. So here's another model of Zero Client here on the desk. It should be noted that the audio is, you know, 3.5mm jacks carrying unbalanced audio. So that should tell you that it's not broadcast grade audio. And at best, if you want to use it in an edit suite, it's really good for like guide voiceovers only, or maybe auditioning, you know, MP3 music, you know, or sound effects, that kind of thing. But it shouldn't be relied on for it's not broadcast grade audio. And what do you expect? You know, it's being compressed like everything else, and so you know, it's not an XLR. You know, it's not carrying high quality audio. So there we go. There's our card. And you can see we've got the winky winky system light is still blue. So the card hasn't actually booted up yet. Oh, winky winky system light is green. So it's booted up. But the link light isn't on because nothing's connected to this card yet. There's one nice little feature here. So it's quite an elaborate cable harness that comes out the back of one of these cards, because it obviously has to have two DVIs and a bunch of other stuff. And it's it can be a very long cable harness because maybe the chassis is in one bay and the workstation's two bays away. And so you notice there's an ID button on the top of the card. If I press the ID button, the system light lit winks. And then at the end of the cable harness, there's a little winking LED. So you can
go know which one you're playing with.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. I've lost your video, Hugh. That may just be a bandwidth issue.
Oh, it could be. Yes. Oh.
No worries. So anyway, there we go. There's our card, and here's the Zero client that's connected to the same network switch that this card is connected to. So I'm just going to go over here, and you'll notice that this Zero client has it's branded for Route 6. That's all just kind of stuff, isn't it? So if I hit the connect button, Because we don't have an authentication server on this network, it's just our workshop, you know, with a couple of bits and bobs on it. It will go off and scan the network, and it'll see what cards are available, what PCOIP devices are available. And there's only one, and it's listed there. So if I hit the OK button, it will then connect it, and it says no source signal. Is that because that Mac has gone to sleep? Come on, John. There we go. There we go. So we can see that the Mac's booting up there. And this is another thing that people are often they're not used to seeing on remote desktop systems. They're not used to seeing the boot up screens of their computers, because they're thinking, oh, this is a bit like VNC, or this is a bit like Windows Remote Desktop. I'm only going to see a display when the operating system loads. But this is not. This is a transparent. Wouldn't you know it? While this Mac was sitting on in our workstation yesterday, it's clearly done a system update, and you can see it's updating its firmware as we speak. So I am going to have to edit a little bit of this just to make it flow a bit nicer. But
take a little while before it comes.
Yeah. So anyway,
are in fact sitting in front of your computer. It's just you've got a long piece of wire.
Yes, a very long virtualized piece of wire. Mm, you know,
virtual piece of
running over the internet. Okay, jolly good. So there's our machine booting up, and I've got a cheap Logitech webcam pointed at this, and there's no way you'll be able to see how responsive this is. But if you've ever sat behind a Teradici based solution, you'll know it really is just like having the machine under your desk. It's very rare that you can spot that things aren't right. In fact, when I demo these at customers' facilities, I say to the engineer, can I just put it in? And we don't tell the editor that he's editing over a PCOIP extension system. And just see if he notices. Because if you don't tell them, they don't notice. If you do tell them, it's kind of that kind of... they'll sit there watching very complicated video playback. Did you see that? Did you see it? Was that compressed? Did you see, you know... And of course, if they think they can see it, they will see it. But when they don't know what they're looking for, they don't spot it. So that's that. So anyway, there we go. There's our Amulet Zero client connected through this cheap and cheerful little £50 network switch to this Amulet card. And you could edit all day long, and you'd never spot the fact that you're being extended over a network. So what I'm going to show you now is, if I go to another browser, Safari, and let's make that window smaller because that's in the way now. And let's maybe go back to yours truly. So what I've done here is this browser here is I've pointed it at the IP address of the Zero client. The Zero client, as well as being a Teradici Zero client, also has a little web server built in for configuration, all that kind of stuff, and it's giving us a few statistics. So it's been sitting up and running on the workshop bench for a bit more than a week. It tells us that what card it's connected to. So that's the IP address of the card it's connected to. Mm-hmm. So if I open that in a new tab, we'll go to that. Now there's something we'll get back to in a minute, and it's asking me to log in to the card. So there we go. And it looks broadly similar to the Zero client, it's giving us a bunch of statistics about data rates and such, and so we're sort of averaging. So our maximum bandwidth so far has been what is that? This is in kilobits per second. So we've been averaging a megabit per second. Yeah, and I think we're topping out at 8 megabits per second. Very, very modest, you know. There we go. There's a bunch of configuration stuff, network details and all that kind of stuff. Permissions, this is rather splendid. You can blacklist and whitelist different USB types. So if you're worried about people plugging in a USB stick in the edit suite, you can disallow all USB storage devices. Or you can whitelist only keyboards and mice. Nothing else is allowed. So you can blacklist and whitelist different USB devices. That's rather good.
That's a good idea.
This is the card, the sender. and you know, it tells us what IP address it's connected to, and you know, there's a whole bunch of stuff about limiting bandwidth and you know, all that kind of stuff. And this is all very nice to manage if you've just got a few of these things, but consider the poor network admin at Macquarie's Bank in Sydney in Australia, who has 1,600 seats of this stuff, ooh, all running on a flat IP6 network. You know, managing that is a real mission. And so there are a couple of bits of software. There's a free bit of software that Teradici make called the Management Console, which allows you to you know, update firmware, do group based configuration changes, and all that kind of stuff. It even allows you to connect a card to a Xero client remotely. And so our friends at MPC, that's exactly how they run their network. There's somebody in the bookings department has that software running on their PC. And in the morning, they don't allow the editors and the operators to fiddle with the Amulet. In the morning, somebody in bookings goes in and they say, oh, well, I see we're using Flame 3 workstation in Edit 2 today. And they go and they do a drag and drop. And if you should be in the edit suite at that point, all of a sudden you see the screen suddenly connect to Flame 3 and they're ready to go. So that's the Management Console. It's very useful for, you know, updating firmware. And you can do nice things like, you can say, update all the Xero clients in the graphics department to this version of firmware, but don't do it until 4 o'clock tomorrow morning. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's all very good. And then there's another piece of software called LeoStream, which is what they call an authentication broker. And it will, so let me go back to that other camera. The Logitech. So you can see that. And if I go here, and if I press the disconnect button on my Xero client, so we go back to the Xero client's interface. Does that give us? That's a bit. It's not nice, is it? We see that quite clearly, can't we? So if I go into the options on my Xero client, into the configuration page, and unlock it. And I go into my session tab, you'll notice that I've got several kinds of sessions.
Yeah, I can read it. Well, I can see it anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe I'll just make the window a bit bigger. So you'll notice that we've got a few options in our session tab. The first one is direct to host, and that is as you'd expect. You just enter in the IP address of the card you want to connect to. Mm-hmm. And then every time that Xero client wakes up, it will attempt to connect to that host. Then we've got direct to host with SLP host discovery. So what this does is when the Xero client wakes up, it scurries across the network and it sees what free hosts are available, and it presents them in a drop down. And then there's a few other things, essentially based around sort of kiosk and, kind of point of sale and, big monitors hung from gantries in football stadium type modes. And then the one at the very bottom there, so let's...
Connection management interface.
Connection management interface. So if I select that, it then asks me for an IP address or a host name of a connection management server. And... what's worth pointing out at this point is that Amulet is a Teradici-based product. Teradici mm-hmm. is in itself a hardware implementation of VMware's VDI protocol.
Oh, is it right?
So if you're familiar with how VMware works in data centers, it's a hardware implementation of that. VMware VDI, that's what I'm interesting about. And so consequently, there is a plethora of management software to manage VDI environments. It's all over the shop. And so LeoStream, although not specifically aimed at either Teradici or Amulet, is perfect for managing big Teradici deployments. You can maintain a list of usernames and passwords locally on the Teradici on the LeoStream server, or you can have the LeoStream server look elsewhere for that authentication information. So you can have it look to your Windows domain controller or your LDAP mm-hmm. server if you're a big Mac environment. And what that means is, I say, okay, I've got a LeoStream service on this IP address. I put that into the box on the Xero client, or I've probably set that up as a group policy thing within my management console. And then when the Xero client wakes up, it goes off to the LeoStream server and it says, What do I need to do? And the Learstream server will say, ask him for a username and password. So you then get a drop-down that says, what's your username and password? And if you are, you know, deprecating that up to your Windows domain controller, that's your Windows login username and password. And so you type that in, and then the Learstream server says, oh, jolly good, you're authenticated. You're Dave the editor. You've got access to one of three AVIDs. Or you're, Kerry, the machine room supervisor, you've got access to all the AVIDs. And it will offer you only the machines that are pertinent to you. And so that's how, for example, IMG Sports and ITV run their networks using a Learstream server. And it's a really rather splendid situation. Now, those other manufacturers, they have brokering servers. And in fact, in the case of both Adalink and Avasant, they are required. You have to have a brokering server. You can't run wild and free on IP addresses like you can on an Amulet network if you want to. If you don't feel the need for an authentication server, and so consequently they charge you handsomely. So typically they're charging you.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So let's go back to our comparison. They are typically charging you, in the case of both Avasant and Adalink, they're charging you. I think Avasant's server is a £7,000 box, and because you have to have it, you better have a backup one. You better have the hot spare, and I think the Adalink one is again a £3,000 box that they sell you, but you better have the spare one. With Amulet, you can have a Learstream server on your network or not if you don't want. And on a Friday afternoon, when the Learstream server goes down, because servers go down, the first fallback position is that the box has cached all that authentication information, and you might not even notice there's no Learstream server listening anymore. But worst case, the box will have to fall back to connecting to an IP address. But, you know, if that kind of keeps you editing, that's all well and good, isn't it? You know.
Yeah, yeah. Still in business.
Whereas, you know, Avasant and Adalink, you are looking at spending many thousands of pounds on a proprietary authentication server and a backup one just in case. So, wow. We kind of think that's rather good. Now, the last thing I wanted to talk about with respect to all this kind of nonsense is encryption.
Yes.
Because the one thing that has allowed us to sell Amulet into those kinds of facilities that deal with the MPAA or the FACT or Marvel and Disney, who I think are now the same company, aren't they? Is that you have?
Are they really?
Yeah, you have to have a rock solid network, because these guys are so worried about material leaking onto the internet.
Now, well, the material is extremely valuable to people.
Yeah, so. it's their lifeblood, isn't it? So,
dodgy blokes are after it.
You have to have the ability to encrypt on the wire, and so let's just have a little think about encryption. Because it's a kind of a reasonably complicated subject. Well, it's not too complicated, but it's worth kind of, you know, starting, you know, a little bit of a sort of a 5 minutes of 101.
Because you're quite keen on encryption anyway. I know you take an interest in it anyway.
We run a little 1 day course, sort of IT for broadcast, sort of networks and broadcast engineers, and we talk quite a lot about encryption on it. And crypto crops up in other areas of the media. So HDMI, you know, HDCP, and all that kind of is crypto bound. If it wasn't for encryption between your web browser and Mr. eBay server or Mr. PayPal server, Mr. Amazon server, there would be no shopping on the internet. There would be none of the money-making activity that goes on the internet, or the very fine Riding Diary website, I don't doubt.
quite right.
So, and it's extended into our world for things like... I'm actually just going to turn this Amulet chassis off because I'm sure...
It's nice when it stops, and
what's coming through in our sort of end of the industry now is DPP deliverables, so delivering your file-based media to your broadcaster. You might be doing it over Signiant or some file delivery mechanism like that, or secure FTP, but again it's something that has to be secured. You have to be able to deliver it over an inherently insecure network, the internet, but be ensured that it is, you know, free from prying eyes, you know. And remote workers working on a network, they have to be able to VPN in, you know. So encryption is a fact of life now. And we really have to, there's kind of three concepts in encryption. There's what we call symmetric cryptography, where the same key is used to encrypt the data and decrypt the data. asymmetric, or sometimes known as public key crypto, where we have separate encrypting and decrypting keys. We'll talk a little bit about how that works. And hashing, which is another concept in cryptography where you take a blob of data and you turn it into what they call a digest, you know, a unique number of a certain size, that were you to change a single bit in the original data, in the original file, in the original, you know, blob of data you were considering, the hash changes radically, you know. And there's no mathematical way of relating the hash back to the data. So it's a one-way function, if you will. That's quite important in crypto.
Is that the one favoured of bad guys, encrypting your data for money? Well,
your hashes are invariably used to prove things. So if you ever download from GitHub or something like that, they'll say, and the MD5 hash for this file is, and if you get the file and you run that through an MD5 hash maker and you get a different hash, you think, ha-ha, this file has been altered. If the file was altered by just a single bit, the hash changes radically. So hashing, you know, like when you put your card into the ATM and you type your number in on the ATM terminal, your number isn't actually stored on your cash card. A hash of your number is stored on the cash card, impossible to reverse the hash back to the number. And the first thing the ATM machine does, the first thing the ATM does is that it hashes the number you just typed in on the keypad and then compares the hash to the hash on your card.
Actually, they're the same. To make sure that's how we handle passwords as well. So you hash them. We never get to see what a person's password looks like. Just see if the nonsense that's produced from the maths is the same as the nonsense we've got stored.
And well-run websites should always do that. They should never, ever let passwords out. And this has been the scandal of Target in America and other big websites where their databases have got loose, that it turns out they weren't hashing the passwords at all. They were storing them in the clear. And guess what? You know, people tend to use the same password for 100 different websites, including their banking website. So symmetric cryptography is the kind of thing you did as a kid with like a code wheel. You know, I always remember some of those, World War II comics that I used to read as a kid in the 70s, or 2000 AD, like a science fiction comic I used to read as a kid. You know, you'd periodically get like a free gift on the front cover, and it would be like two cardboard discs with a split pin, and you know, you'd set a position of the wheel, and then you could encrypt a message, and that's a substitution cipher, sometimes referred to as a Caesar cipher, because the Roman army used it. And
did they? Right.
Yeah, and then they were subsequently developed into what they call rotating Caesar ciphers, because of course, how do you attack a Caesar cipher? You just look at blinking character frequencies, and you know that for any given language, you know what the relative frequencies are of the characters. E occurs the most, then T and S and A and whatever, and so it's very trivial without having to have access to the key, just having access to the crypto text, to be able to turn the crypto text back into the plain text by knowing something about it. And so a Caesar cipher is very insecure, and so quite quickly, even in Roman days, they invented the rotating Caesar cipher, it was called, where that would typically be a piece of wood of a known diameter, and you'd wrap a piece of ribbon around it, or a piece of cloth, and so every six or eight characters, you'd come back to the first Caesar cipher. But actually, Sir Isaac Newton figured out how to break those back in 1680 or whatever, and in fact the British government paid him not to tell anybody that the fact they could break them. And so for 200 years British intelligence was reading French diplomatic traffic, because the French were still using a rotating Caesar cipher. The French used to refer to it as le chiffre undecipherable, the undecipherable cipher, but the British Secret Service were reading it, because Isaac Newton had just figured out you figure out how big the step is, and then you attack that using frequency analysis. Now, the most famous example of a rotating Caesar cipher machine is the Enigma machine from the Second World War.
Of course.
Typically three or four rotators, and every time you press a key, that one rotates, then when that's rotated 26 times, the next one gets nudged and it rotates once. And so you have a constantly rotating Caesar cipher. But we're not just dealing with like a rotation interval of six now, we're dealing with a rotation interval of many billions, you know. Enigma machines, when properly used, are almost unbreakable. It was only the fact that that 19-year-old German wireless operators would make hideous errors and send the same message three times that allowed Bletchley Park to get what they call these cribs, and the fact that an Enigma machine can never encode a letter back to itself. So an A always encodes to something other than an A, etc. And so with those two little bits of information, you can... But the German Navy, who had much more experienced wireless operators who followed the book and didn't use these sloppy procedures, German naval traffic was very rarely broken by Bletchley Park. And so the Enigma machine is like the ultimate example of a rotating Caesar cipher, and it's a symmetric cipher. You know, it's the same machine and the same initial starting position that allows you to decrypt as encrypted. Now, this is all very splendid. You know, when used properly, it is almost unbreakable. But the problem is, if you're running a website that does online shopping, how do you agree the initial key with the person you're dealing with? How do you set this up? Because if the bad guy is sniffing your traffic to see the data go past, the credit card number goes past, and all that kind of stuff, he might have seen the key go past, and therefore you don't want to be in the situation that he's hoovered up the key and now he's hoovering up the data and he'll be able to decrypt it, no matter how good your cipher is. And so in the 70s, this idea of asymmetric key cryptography arose, where you wouldn't have the same number that was used as an encrypting key as a decrypting key. And the maths surrounding this is very complicated. It essentially comes down to the fact that it's very hard to factorize a large number that is the product of two large prime numbers. It's devilishly difficult to factorize that back into the prime numbers, because you just have to test everything. And we're not talking about numbers in the millions or the billions. We're talking about numbers thousands of binary digits long. So numbers that are, you know, Google zillions, you know, they're massive numbers. And so you derive a public and a private key that are built from... So one key is the product of two primes, and the other key is one of the primes. And so you keep the big number safe. That's the private key. That one lives on Mr. Amazon's web server and never gets out. And the public key, you publish. And you publish it by sticking it in the certificate store of people's web browsers. So when you download the latest copy of Firefox or Internet Explorer or Safari or Mozilla or whatever your favorite web browser is, the web browser gets a few hundred public keys of various key authorities. You know, there are companies that just kind of specialize in this: VeriSign, Thought, Equifax. You know, there's a few of them. And so that means that you can have a situation where you can encrypt something with your public key, pass it back to a web server that can decrypt it with their private key, and no unencrypted data went over the wire, and no key went over the wire either. So the man in the middle, the bad guy listening to your connection, he's still stuck. He can't do anything about this. The other nice thing is that you can... But public key crypto, asymmetric crypto, is very mathematically intense. You couldn't use it to encrypt all your web traffic. You definitely couldn't use it to encrypt your PC over IP session between your Amulet, you know, desktop box and your Amulet sender card.
It takes too much maths to do.
Yeah, you need a supercomputer to take care of it. You can do a little bit of it. You can encrypt and decrypt a small amount of data in a sensible amount of time, but you couldn't do it with the bulk of the data you're dealing with. But that's no problem, because all you do is you generate what they call an ephemeral key, a one-time use key, a symmetric key. You encrypt it using the public key of the web server in question, and you can then give them that, and you can say, there you go, there's the key we're now going to use for our symmetric encipherment. And because symmetric is so easy to do, it can be done in hardware, or it can be done very, very quickly. It's typically very simple mathematical operations. It's typically XORing. XORing the data is what it is. You're off to the races. You've got a secure, very quick to use, no impact on computation required, symmetric key that has safely been agreed by doing it over an asymmetric encryption connection. I've got a little grab I did from the copy of Firefox that's running on my laptop here. If you go into Firefox, you can look at the web certificates, and there's a certificate for Equifax. And in fact, if you drill down into that, if you open up that certificate, you can actually see what the certificate looks like. And in fact, that scrolls down that box. So typically, it'll be 2,000 digits or 4,000 digits is more common nowadays for an asymmetric key, and that would then negotiate maybe a 256 bit key for mm-hmm. the symmetric encryption session. And that's why, yeah, when that all
so
happens.
So what we're doing is we're saying we're passing the key across, but we're going to scramble what that key is. So the man in the middle just doesn't know.
Yeah, yeah. The key,
not without several supercomputers to help him, and even then.
Well, supercomputers and the lifetime of the universe. You know, these really are, you know, phenomenally large numbers to deal with, you know. And people say, oh, well, perhaps they've invented quantum computing, where, you know, a quantum computer can answer every question simultaneously. And you think to yourself, well, surely you've just changed the problem from being one of computation into one of being sorting a massive data set. You know, a data set that needs more memory than has ever been invented. You know, so
yes,
so I, you know,
right.
I think when done correctly, encryption is bulletproof. And, you know, we could talk a lot about Mr. Cameron and all the nonsense he's talking about providing backdoors for the intelligence community to be, you know, it can't work, and it can't work for very good technical reasons. Hopefully that'll all go away very quickly. But just a sort of a little thing there, there's what you see when you type in a URL of an SSL, or it's actually now called TLS. That's the new name for SSL, or has been for a few years now. Yeah, transport layer security. Transport layer security. So you get the padlock closes, and in the case of big value properties like PayPal, you get the green extended validation certificate. Extended validation certificates are more expensive, and when VeriSign sells you an extended, an EV cert as they call them, they will put people on a couple of days worth of work to check out your company to make sure you are who you say you are, because, you know, VeriSign's neck is on the line should that go wrong.
Yeah.
It's a what they call a web of trust. You know, we are trusting the person who serves up the certificate, that they're vouching for the person they say they're vouching for. So that's how it all works, essentially. And then we mentioned hashing functions, so we should probably just come back to that. That, you know, hashing functions are a one-way function, and they're used to confirm things. So, you know, when the website says to you, "Hello, I'm Mr. PayPal," and here's a hash of my private key. My public key. You can then look at the public key that you got when you downloaded your browser. You can do a hash of that, and you say, oh, the hash is the same. Yes, I believe you are Mr. PayPal. There's no way you could have spoofed that kind of thing. So hashes are very useful in that respect, and they're very useful for confirming the authenticity of files and all that kind of stuff. But bringing this conversation all the way back round to our KVM over IP, Teradici is the only manufacturer who does the right thing in their key exchange. So they burn their private keys into silicon, and they do a proper symmetric key exchange when a receiver tries to connect to a sending device, and they mm-hmm. and they negotiate a symmetric key for use on the session. Now, the upshot of this is that, you know, the key never passes over the wire unencrypted, and unencrypted data never passes between the two. But what it means is that the poor little, you know, 400 megahertz processor, Linux system on a chip processor in here, momentarily has a big job to do in that asymmetric exchange. And so people often criticize Teradici solutions because they take a couple of seconds to make an initial connection.
Because they're doing the maths.
Yeah. You know, Avasant connects immediately. Adalink connects immediately. But that's because they do their key exchange in the clear. And so although they're encrypted on the wire, the bad guy could just sit and watch the key go past, and now he's got the keys to the kingdom. And this is further shown by virtue of the fact that with Adalink in particular, they boast that you can have several Adalink endpoints connected to the same sender, and they can all be showing the same desktop. With Amulet, it's impossible, because Amulet negotiates a key session between a sending card and a receiving zero client.
It's a unique connection,
and no force on earth can make any sense of that outside of the tunnel that's been created by those two endpoints. And so when people say, oh, but, you know, I want, you know, a system where I can do, you know, one to many, I say, well, you've just got to put a DA on the back of the computer and DA it into several sender cards, because, you know, these guys take crypto seriously. And the reason you can do that with other manufacturers is because they don't take crypto seriously. So, So there you go. That's my little quick canter through KVM over IP and why we've made the choices we have. Why we think you know Amulet is the one to go with. And I mean, as I say, they are a great company. Their background is financial services. That's where they come from. And you know, broadcast for them is a tiny little backwater. We are their, you know, their reseller. You can't buy Amulet from anybody else if you work in our industry. And you know, but
very,
you know,
good indeed.
You know, we hold demo stock, so you know, if people ever need to sort of like demo it in their facility, and I always recommend that to people. You know, test it with your application. My colleague Matt Ward, he says something where he says, if you show somebody something that looks a bit like magic, they'll expect magical things of it. And there are limits to this technology. You know, I had one customer in Germany putting a full screen moving zone plate through an Amulet connection. And yeah, you know, that's the most challenging video signal there could be. You know, it's everything is changing from frame to frame. And he said, oh, I can see the compression artifacts. I said, well, hey, you know.
Yeah, congratulations.
What a surprise, you know. But is that what you're buying this for? So you can distribute moving zone plates around? Or are you buying it so that people can remote into their Avid from you know, la-di-da?
Somewhere else. Bless them. Just, you mentioned Bletchley Park. Of course, a lot of the people who watch this won't know what Bletchley Park is. So what is Bletchley Park?
So have you not been to Bletchley Park?
I've not been yet. Bletchley I've been Park past Bletchley lots of times.
It's a fantastic day
I'd like
out.
To go in.
It's so Bletchley Park was the very hastily constructed it was the what was it called, the National Code School, the National Cipher School, where they were intercepted German, you know, Axis traffic, yeah, radio wireless traffic would be decrypted. Now, famously, Bletchley Park could decrypt most days the Enigma traffic, and the Enigma was a machine that the German army used very extensively for all their sort of lower level military traffic. The Enigma was not a German army invention. It was actually invented by a Polish company in the 1920s, and was kind of sold into the banking industry. Well, a bit like Amulet.
Yes, nothing's changed. Just the technology.
And the idea was that it was a mechanical analog electronic encryption machine that could be used for sending important financial information across telegraphs. And they recognised at the time that telegraph operators would routinely be bribed by people to pass copies of the things they were sending to third parties. Or in fact, you know, telegraph wires, you know, if it's going across, you know, hundreds of miles of countryside, you shinny up two croc clips and you're listening to the traffic. And so the Enigma machine was sold as a way to beat that, you know, that before you handed the message over to the Morse operator, would tap it out on his thing. It would be encrypted using an Enigma machine, and you'd hand him what just looked like gibberish, you know, just letters. And he'd send that, and at the other end, you would have agreed the initial setup state of your Enigma machine, and you'd be able to decrypt it at the other end. And it's got, you know, it's got a keyboard that looks a bit like a typewriter, and it's got these rotors that are the rotating mechanism that changes the encipherment on every letter push, and you've got a lamp board. So, you know, you set the machine up in the state that you want to start working with it at. You press the A key, and the, you know, for example, the G light lights up, and at the other end, so long as the machine was set up in the same state, when you press the G button on the keyboard, the A light lights up. So it's a symmetric rotating Caesar cipher machine, but a very, very complicated one. And when used correctly, they are almost unbreakable. But German 19-year-old German wireless operators would just not follow the rules. And the very, very clever people at Bletchley Park, very sort of clever mathematicians, language experts.
And if you haven't, if anybody hasn't followed it, the stories of Bletchley Park are absolutely fascinating on all sorts of levels, technical levels, of human levels, and just fascinating. It really is. It's an amazing story. And not least is the story of saving it, because the place was falling to pieces. And yeah. I think a number of people, including Messrs. Google and Sons, have put some money into it to restore it or bring the place back to life.
So of course, you know, Bletchley Park very quickly figured out that it could speed up their decryption operations by using, you know, the height of electromechanical information processing of the time. And so essentially computing started in part at Bletchley Park. I've got a picture now of the Colossus, which was a, it's not a programmable computer in the sense that we would recognise one today, but it was what computer scientists would call Turing complete. It could do all the operations that make it a computer. But to reprogram it, you essentially had to rewire the thing. But it was used to break not Enigma traffic, but Lorenz traffic, which was another encryption machine the Germans used. So here's, what is this? This is, there was a machine that was invented at Bletchley called the BOM, which was actually a refinement of a Polish invention, which essentially would just check letter combinations mechanically, and they've still got them there working. If you're at all interested in this stuff, go to Bletchley Park because it's
definitely
a great day.
Yes, I'm dying to go.
And they've got women who work there, or kind of that generation, women in their 70s, 80s, who kind of do the tour and do the demos, and they kind of load up these oily, noisy machines, and they set letters on big kind of wheels, and they set the thing going, and it's a huge, great noise, and after a few minutes, one letter locks into position. A, we know how that's enciphered, and just these people were so clever because essentially using little more than the technology of telephone exchanges and relays and valves, they built computers that essentially brought the war to a close 18 months ahead of time. So, they were heroic in every sense of the world, in every sense of the word. And, Turing and Tommy Flowers and other engineers, well-known sort of founders of computing, of started there. Can't recommend it enough.
No, I'd love to go. And if you're abroad and you're looking for somewhere to go for a very interesting holiday, well, there you should.
Absolutely.
Make your way to Bletchley.
And on the same site is the National Computing Museum.
Yes, of course.
Again, fantastic.
There. Well, an absolutely fascinating conversation. We've romped across a few things. You'd never guess that Phil works for Route 6 and what they sell, but in case it slips through the cracks, they sell Amulet. But now you know why, and it's a careful choice. You can buy cheap and cheerful, but it doesn't do the same thing. So there you go.
Yeah, and just to say that we've got, if you go to our YouTube channel, there's a lot of presentations and a lot of things we've done surrounding this stuff, and our blog is quite voluminous. You can read lots about some of the newer products we're selling and stuff, and of course Engineers Bench podcast with all our previous podcasts on, and I think we're getting towards 30 now, so we've been averaging about 10 a year for the last 3 years, and there's some good stuff in there for people to go back and watch. And we've always tried to make these sessions not particularly timely, so hopefully they'll be meaningful in a year or 2 or 3 years time.
Yes, it'll be very interesting in a few years' time when you come back and look at something else. But there we are. Well, till the next one. Thank you very much, Phil.
Jolly good chap. I'll see you soon, and
you will.
Splendid to talk.
Okay. Cheerio.